Yeah, it's on pause.
All right, very good. So I can see everybody's all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed with, you know, this cold, dark December morning. I'm sure you'd love to hear listening about Potomac pathology. So again, for those of you who weren't here last week, because you are a captive audience, you have to see my travel slides. So we're going back to Lisbon. So this is Lisbon, where the ESCRS was this year. There's the Castillo up on the mountain. Interestingly, Lisbon is a city of hills. There's steep hills, narrow streets. City. This is how you get around Lisbon. This is a tuk-tuk. And so I asked the guy, why did they call it a tuk-tuk? Well, because in Asia, these are diesel powered, so they go tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk, so they have tuk-tuks. Here, they're battery powered, so in essence, it's a glorified golf cart. And so you can see this, it's a glorified golf cart, but it's pretty souped up because it has to get up and down the steep hills. And so, you know, these guys, as you're walking down the street, they're accosting you. You know, oh, you go tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk. So finally, we got some guys that they give you a tour 1 hour. And it says 70 euros. For you, 60 euros. So we got the bargain. So he took us around. So he let us pretend we were driving. And even though he was horrified, we said, can we drive? They said, no way. So this is the good Dr. Crandall. And this is Candy's husband. And so we got a tuk-tuk tour all over. So there's the tuk-tuk. That's the standard street that you have there. So you know why you want a tuk-tuk rather than an actual car. All right, so these are what the streets look like. And every once in a while, you'll just see one that just dead ends, which is interesting. You just pile up here and it just dead ends. And then they've got little cafes and little shops you can stop, get something to eat, and come along. Now, the nice thing is because it's Mediterranean, I mean, the temperature over there was about 80 Fahrenheit. So beautiful, very, very nice, even in October. There's a good Dr. Crandall in his shorts there. Look at those legs. All right, lids. Nico, what do eyelids, ogres, and onions have in common?
Layers.
Layers. Okay, so you really need to know your layers. And so when we're looking at an eyelid grossly, this is from an exenteration, what you see is you see that the eyelid has several layers. What's the outer layer?
Skin.
Skin. And then the layer underneath that?
Muscle.
Muscle. And then the third layer?
Tarsus.
And then the inside layer?
Conjunctiva.
Conj. We always forget that there's conj lining the inside of the eyelid. So remember, the palpebral conj lines the inside surface of the eyelid. So now we're looking at it in a different stain. Tara, what kind of stain is this?
This is
H&E. Trichrome. What makes you say it's trichrome?
Because you can see the basement membrane of the skin.
Actually, does trichrome stain basement membranes?
No.
So what trichrome does do is it'll stain epithelium, it'll stain muscle and connective tissue red, muscle tissue red. It stains connective tissue and collagen blue. And so I really wanted to show you that because here is the skin. This is upside down. Here's the muscle. And then you can see the tarsus is this dense connective tissue. It is in blue. And so you can see that it just delineates some of the different tissues. And then, of course, the cornea is up above. All right, let's look at the skin. Shrav, tell me about the skin of the eyelids.
Stratified squamous keratinized epithelium.
Okay. How is skin of the lid different than skin of, say, the cheek?
Or else from the body? True epithelium?
Mm-hmm. Well, it is an epithelium still, but there's one subtle difference.
There's a layer, the dermis, there's a true epidermis.
Well, when you look at skin elsewhere, there is a true dermis, and in the lid, you don't have dermis. So in the lid, you've got some subepithelial connective tissue, but you don't have dermis. The other thing you don't have is you don't have reedy ridges and pegs. And so, you know, in the normal skin, you've got the indentation, the reedy ridges, the reedy pegs, you've got your reticular dermis, you've got your fat underneath there. Now, lid, you don't normally have dermis underneath it. You normally don't have fat, except in some veterans. So, you know those guys at the VA where the fat pullout really comes forward?
Yep.
So, okay. So now, what are these here, Sharon?
Those are hair shafts.
Exactly. So now remember, in addition to the lashes, the skin, even on the eyelids, has fine hairs. And so just like skin elsewhere, they've got the little sebaceous glands that go with them, you've got the little pilosebaceous units. And so you do have fine hairs even on the lid. You don't think about that. You don't think there's hair on the lids, but there is. And there's fine hairs that are there. All right, so we skipped over the muscle layer here. We'll talk about that later. So you are intern, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you are?
Teresa.
We had brunch with you.
You did.
Okay, it took a second, but I remember. All right, Teresa, so you're at the VA now? Okay, very good. So what are we looking at right here? What is this layer?
It's the meibomian glands.
If those are meibomian glands. And what layer do they live in? What is this layer here called?
It's not the tarsus.
Yeah,
the tarsus.
Tarsus, exactly. So the tarsus is this dense fibrous layer. It really gives body to the lid. It keeps the lid from flopping in and out. And it keeps the lid really stiff and gives it body. What's the difference between tarsus in a primate and tarsus in rats and rabbits?
I have no idea.
Cartilage. Believe it or not, subprimates have cartilage in the tarsus, so they're really, really strong. So if you're ever doing research on rabbits and rats, their lids are just really strong and really hard, and it's the cartilage. Whereas in the primates, you don't have that. So we've got right here the meibomian glands, and it's interesting. They dump into a central orifice here, and then that dumps out at the posterior surface of the lid. So I say this is akin to grapes on a vine. So you know how grapes cluster, and then there's a central vine. So when you look at the meibomian glands, here's this central duct, and then the meibomian glands are the grapes that are on here. Okay, so let's go a little bit closer. Now, we can't not talk about glands. And I know glands are boring, but we want to talk about glands. And so there are three main categories of glands. So what is this one? Something that's working very hard right now in your body.
Sweat glands.
Sweat glands, exactly. So what class of glands are sweat glands?
Eccrine. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So the lid is interesting because the lid has all three types of glands. And so eccrine glands are what you think of as sweat glands, but also eccrine glands are the lacrimal glands. So around the eye, the accessory lacrimal glands, the main lacrimal glands, which are, you know, overactive in me right now when I ask you guys these questions. It makes me want to cry here. So. But these are the eccrine glands. And so eccrine glands, they cluster in what are called acini. And so they form these little round clusters. They secrete into the center. Eventually they gather up into ducts and then proceed out. So these are your eccrine glands. And they often have these little eosinophilic staining secretory granules here in the cytoplasm. So these are what lacrimal glands look like. These are what sweat glands look like. Now we're right here at the lid margin. And the reason I'm showing the lid margin is the lid margin has two other types of glands that are in here. So the second gland I want to show you is this gland. Let's go one more and then we'll come back. Okay, so we're looking at this gland right here. What kind of gland is this?
Let's see, is this an apocrine gland?
It's an apocrine gland. And how do we tell apocrine glands from simple eccrine glands?
So they have the snout.
Snouts. Look at these little snouts sticking out. So apocrine glands, just like the name says, they put their little apexes into the gland, and then when they secrete, sometimes these little apexes get chopped off. And so they look like little snouts. Now, what's the name of the apocrine gland that lives in the eyelid?
The glands of mole.
Gland of mole. And how do we remember that?
Because it's like a mole that has a snout.
Exactly. So what kind of animal has a snout? A mole. So the glands of mole are the apocrine glands. And that's how you remember them, because they have snouts. So these are the apocrine glands, glands of mole. And as we go back here, what happens is the apocrine glands dump into the eyelash follicles. And so right at the lid margin is where the lashes come out. You have these glands of mole dumping in, but also on the eyelashes you have a second type of gland. And what gland is that?
Those are the glands of Zeiss.
Glands of Zeiss, and what group are they in?
Holocrine.
Holocrine glands. Now, what distinguishes holocrine glands is holocrine glands are like kamikaze glands. They secrete their entire contents into the lumen. So they really regurgitate everything in there. So for those of you who do imbibe, and remember those days in college when you had too many of the two carbon disease, and you're praying to the porcelain god to help you live through the night, what were you doing? You were regurgitating all of your contents into that white porcelain god. And so that's what meibomian glands do. They're a sebaceous gland. And so they dump all of this lipid-rich material. Now for the Zeiss glands, they dump it into the hair follicle. And for the meibomian glands, they dump it into the meibomian duct. All right, what's important about the meibomian gland secretions? What do they do?
So they form the oily portion of the tear film.
Exactly, so they form the outer layer of the tear film. They keep the aqueous tears, which the eccrine lacrimal glands produce, from evaporating. And so these are lipid-rich glands. If you look at H&E stain, they've got kind of this ground glassy appearance. They've got all this lipid stuff in here. And so these are the lipid-producing meibomian glands. And this is welcome. We even get real pathologists here. So what the...
I'm Megan. I'm the neuropath fellow, in case you guys are curious.
So what kind of stain is this?
This is oil red on. It's on fresh tissue.
Exactly. So if you want to stain lipid, remember what we talked about. Oil red on is an easy stain to remember because it stains oil, these little red O's. And so little red O's, very easy to remember. And so this is a piece of fresh meibomian gland stained with an oil red O stain. So it shows all the lipid that's in. All right, so now we're going to look at some lid lesions. And unfortunately, when you look at lid lesions, they all look kind of the same from the outside. So you need to try to come up with a differential diagnosis of what you're looking at. All right, so what do we see in here?
So it's an external photograph of the right eye. And there's a lesion on the lower lid. Looks fairly fleshy colored. Not a whole lot of pigment changes, maybe some pigmentation on the upper surface, but it also could just be a shadow there, and some irregularity at the lid margin as well.
So when you're looking at lid lesions, one of the important things is you want to look and say, is this something that's potentially bad? Is this a potential tumor, or is it just a benign lesion? And there's some hints that you can look at. And some of the things you look at, you say, okay, is there big notch here, is there loss of tissue there, is there loss of lashes here, and here you kind of see, not really, kind of a benign looking just bump on the lid. A lot of people come in and as you look at their eyes, oh, what's this thing, doc? And so, you know, you have to try to figure out what that could be. Now, the other thing that's important, what else, what other surgeries this patient had?
Tell.
Look closer.
Oh, there's a giant PI up top.
Yeah, it's a big PI there. Why would you do a PI? There's an anterior chamber IOL in here. Here's an IOL here. Here's the loop. You come in, here's the loop. Anterior chamber IOL, so this patient had an open intercap. with PI in there and androgen ran well. So this surgery was done at least 30 years ago, so a long time ago. All right, so we go ahead and we just show a couple of other lesions just to see, maybe these look a little bit different. Tina, what are you seeing here?
So again, for external photo, right and left eyes, see lesions present on both eyes. So starting with the right eye, there's one raised lesion on the lower lid that does not appear to be disrupting the hair follicles or the lid margin, but it does look a bit kind of erythematous and edematous. On the left side, similar lesions that still don't really look like they're affecting the hair follicles, but again, more erythematous and edematous and like active inflammatory.
Okay. How old is this patient?
Younger.
Yeah, so it's a child. And so what are you thinking about when you see in multiple lesions like this in a kid?
A little chalazion there.
Exactly. So you're thinking of some kind of benign, like a chalazion or a cordiolum or something like that. And so we look at the pathology on this lesion. What do we see?
Is this where we see the foamy macrophages?
There are some foamy macrophages in here. What is this thing right here? Very big cell.
Giant.
In fact, it's a giant cell. And so you can see a giant cell here, and there's a lot of empty spaces here where the lipid
is
dissolved. Lipogranulomatous inflammation, so this is a chalazion. And so if you want to sound intelligent, you say chalazion. So that, I don't know, it sounds more European. So if you talk European, it makes you sound intelligent. So chalazion. And so this is a reaction. It's not infectious. It's a backup of lipid in the clogged meibomian ducts, which then causes it to swell because lipid is very irritating. And so this is a lipogranulomatous inflammation. This is a chalazion.
Camillus, maybe you're going to answer this, but can you tell on pathology the difference between a chalazion and a hordeolum?
Yes.
Okay.
Because in a hordeolum, usually hordeolums are thought to be infectious. In fact, they're usually staph or something that you get an infection around there, so you don't get the granulomatous inflammation.
Okay.
So that's the difference, is you have a lack of granulomatous inflammation. That's how you tell them apart. Oftentimes on hordeolums, we don't biopsy them or lance them or drain them out, and so we often don't see the path on those. So here's another close-up of a giant cell. Look at all those nuclei around the edges. Look at all this lipid that's dissolved down here. And so again, chalazion. Now you can also have, Nico, what kind of cells are these?
These plasma cells?
Plasma cells. And you can have these?
Lymphocytes.
Lymphocytes. Remember, you don't, you do have giant cells, but you can have lymphocytes, you can have plasma cells in a chronic chalazion. Okay. All right, that didn't count. Now I apologize, I took this picture from a book. I should go to the Moran and get better pictures. But Nico, what are we seeing right here?
So it's a external photograph of the left eye. My extension is drawn in the upper lateral eyelid. There is a raised nodule, or looks like cystic lesion to me.
All right, now
the left lashes.
If you see what you think is a cystic lesion, what's a good way, right in the clinic, an easy way to tell if it's solid or cystic?
You shine the light on it.
Exactly. So you take your little Fanoff head, you can put the light right next to it. If it's cystic, the light will transilluminate right through. If it's solid, it'll block the light. And so that's how you tell the difference between a cystic and a solid. So we do the pathology on this one, and what do we see here?
So there's a stratified squamous kind of cyst, and inside it there is a eosinophilic material that's likely keratin.
Okay. So what do you think this is?
An epidermal occlusion cyst.
So this is called an epithelial inclusion cyst. So we see these not uncommonly. So if we see these in the path lab, invariably it's Megan's turn to do the readout. She's the cyst queen now. So it's not uncommon that you see these, and we call them inclusion cysts because usually it's a sign that something has been done. Either they had a minor trauma or they had a little surgery or something, but for some reason surface epithelium gets stuck underneath, and then it starts to grow and will grow in a circle. So it'll grow in a system, it'll keep making more and more keratin, and with time will get bigger and bigger. So epithelial inclusion cyst. There's a close-up. There's the stratified squamous epithelium. There is the keratin. So when you look at a cyst, the key thing is you look at the lining of the cyst to see what it was that gave rise to the cyst. All right, Tara, what are we seeing right here?
So it looks like another cystic lesion on the lower eyelid.
All right, so again, we put our little Fenoff head on there and it transilluminates, uh-huh. So we know it's cystic. Now, what do we see on the lining of the cyst here?
So this looks like not, the lining doesn't look keratinized, and it looks like it's in two layers.
In two layers, and what's the shape of this one?
It's cuboidal.
Cuboidal. And so if we see a bilayered cuboidal lining to a cyst, what does that mean?
Think of like a hydrocystoma.
Exactly. So this is a hydrocystoma, and it's derived from what?
It's eccrine.
So this is this one, if you look at them, you don't see any snouts. It's very smooth.
Okay.
So this is an eccrine hydrocystoma. So some people think these are derived from the little eccrine ducts rather than from the gland themselves. But it's an eccrine hydrocystoma. So it's got this bilayered cuboidal. It's not stratified. It's not squamous. It's cuboidal, and it does not have snouts. And so it's an eccrine hydrocystoma. So hydrocystoma, from what language? From the Greek, of course. So hydro means water, systoma, cyst. Water cyst, just like that. So always from the Greek. All right, here's the difference. Cyst, try.
So this cyst seems to have more than two layers, several layers around it. It's not round, but more sort of irregularly shaped. Could be as fluid-filled again.
Fluid-filled? What are these right here?
Those are glands of mole. African glands.
Yeah, so those are snouts. And so, believe it or not, even though it depends on how you look at this when it's rolled over, it really is, in most places, about 2 cells thick. Mm-hmm. And snout. So what do we call this?
African cyst.
So just like we had eccrine hydrocystomas, we can have apocrine hydrocystomas. Mm-hmm. And so same thing, they're less common, because obviously glands of mole are less common than some of the eccrine glands. And so, but you can still get in the lids apocrine hydrocystomas. So same thing, they're about to be apocrine gland derived. All right, what are we seeing right here?
So it's a color photograph of the right eye. And kind of along the eyelid, just in between some of the lashes, and then above the lashes are these small, kind of like nodular lesions that are flesh colored, don't have any ulceration or anything. So
you see a little ulceration in the center.
And there's like, there is ulceration in the center.
Almost like a little cratering there, and then these little raised pearly borders, and there's a cluster of them.
Yeah.
What does that tell you?
I've never seen them in a cluster, but like if it has an ulcerated center, would you think about like molluscum?
Exactly. So now actually molluscums usually do come in clusters. So they're often in clusters. So this is molluscum. This is a good classic appearance of molluscum. You can see it's got the little raised pearly border, the little indentation in the center, and there's a cluster of it. And so when you look at the path, nothing else looks like this. So tell me what the path shows here.
So there's like all these keratinocytes that are all like heaped up and below. There's an ulcerated center that has some inflammation at the top. I think they're like kind of like the top layer is ulcerated, and there's all the inflammatory cells.
So when we look at a close-up, what are these little eosinophilic areas here? These kind of start at the base and then work their way to the top.
They almost look like, are they capillaries?
Believe it or not, those are actually viral inclusions in cells. And so what happens with molluscum is that the virus gets into the epithelial cells, it'll start growing, and eventually it pushes the nucleus to the side. And by the time you get to the top, it just pushes that nucleus out completely, and the virus takes over the whole cell. So the cell right here is nothing more than a bag of viruses, which is why you get these clusters. And so you'll get the little virus will spread all over. What kind of virus is this usually? It's one of the pox viruses, usually. So that's most common. So this is classic molluscum. When you see these eosinophilic staining inclusions, and then you see that the epithelium is thickened, it's raised on the edges, it's umbilicated in the center, and you've got all these just bags of viruses ready to dump it out in the tissue next to it. So this is classic molluscum. They call it contagiosum. You know, contagium means, you know, germs spreading all over. And so it's because it spreads all over, it's molluscum contagiosum. All right, again, I took this picture out of the book because I don't carry cameras with me like the plastics guys do. All right, what are we seeing here?
Okay, so this is an external photograph of the left and right eye. Looks like on the right eye we have a lesion on the superior eyelid nasally. It looks, you know, flesh colored, doesn't look like there's any erythema surrounding it, slightly raised, no ulceration.
What would you think? What would your differential be here?
So this looks like it, it could be xanthlasma.
Exactly.
Xanthlasma.
All right. So when you see this, we call it plaque-like. So instead of the big cyst sticking out or something, you know, bilocated and ulcerated, this is like a flatter plaque that's elevated, and it's almost kind of yellow in color. Mm-hmm. So you look at that, when you think yellow, you think more lipid. And so this is a xanthlasma, it's called. And when we look at it, what kind of cells characterize xanthlasma?
So it's going to be lipid-filled.
Okay.
So
what kind of cells gobble up that lipid and get filled with them?
Apocrine.
Yep. Macrophages.
Okay.
Macrophages. So, and you can see they're just stuffed. I mean, they just come in there and they just, they Pac-Man all that lipid, you know, so they're all just stuffed with lipid. And you can see right here, these are macrophages, just stuffed with lipid. Now, it used to be top. Yes, sir.
So if you're just looking at that photo there, how would you differentiate a foamy macrophage from an adipocyte?
Because it actually has a body to it where the adipocyte is just filled with just pure fat. Where this actually has got this kind of granularity to it. And it's got the nucleus there that's round and to the side, as opposed to the adipocyte where it's flat and pushed over. So the adipocyte, the nucleus is pushed over and really flat, and the cytoplasm is empty. This actually has some substance to it, and the nucleus is round while it's still pushed to the side. Some of them you can see the nucleus more in the center. So it was taught at one time that these were a sign of high cholesterol. So people used to get worked up all the time for high cholesterol, but it really doesn't turn out to be true. Now, you can get these with high cholesterol, but it doesn't necessarily mean if you have a xanthelasma that you have high cholesterol. So it just turned out not to be true. All right, different kind of lesion here.
All right, this looks, this is a color photo externally of the right eye, and it looks like the lesion is below the lower lid margin. It's a little more, it does look raised, but not quite as cystic like we'd seen before, a little more plaque-like, a rough surface on top, and very flesh-colored.
View the path, what do we see in here at low power?
So it looks, so that the epidermis looks a little thickened.
Okay, it looks a lot thickened.
Yeah, a lot thickened.
So, okay, so You've got thick epithelium. What is this stuff here?
Is it keratin?
Keratin. So you've got these big crypts filled with keratin. You've got these big cysts filled with keratin. So thick epithelium. You've got all these big crypts and cysts filled with keratin. And you look at a close-up here.
Yeah, you got keratinization.
All these crypts filled with keratin here. So what do you think this would be?
It looks like a squamous papilloma.
Exactly. So this is a papilloma. And so the way we remember this, a papilloma looks like a gloved hand sticking out. So it's got a thick glove, which is the epithelium, and it's got these little fibrovascular cores in the center. And so papilloma is the lesion. And sometimes when you see them in cross-section, you see the thick epithelium surrounding these little fibrovascular cores. And think of it as someone took the gloved hand and they just cut the fingertips off. And so when you see it in a flat record in cross-section, you see the little fibrovascular core in the center, you see the thick epithelium around it, you see the hyperkeratosis. So these can be either infectious or not. So they can sometimes just be something irritates the squamous epithelium. Sometimes these can be infectious also. Alright, what are we seeing here?
This looks like a pedunculated lesion. It's flesh colored, it's a little more erythema to it though. Looks like there's multiple kind of subunits kind of stuck on, like maybe like a sebaceous carrot.
Yeah, you see that kind of stuck on look, that kind of dried, crusty, keratin looking stuff on there. So this would be more like a seborrheic keratosis. And so sometimes seborrheic keratoses look a lot like papillomas. It's hard to tell. But the way you can tell them apart is, remember, the papillomas come out like the gloved hand. The seborrheic keratoses, the epithelium tends to go down in like a hairy spider. So the big hair surrounds it, and you've got the little the little areas of the glands inside, the little vessels inside. Now, the other thing is, right along the basilar layer here, you see this very often in seborrheic keratosis. What's going on here?
Would you call that palisading?
Well, it always palisades at the base. Any squamous epithelium will palisade at the base, but what else do you see on here?
I don't know.
Pigment.
Oh, yeah.
And so you see some benign melanocytes lining up along the base. And so for some reason, seborrheic keratoses tend to pigment. So when you look at them, they'll often be brown. In fact, people will often mistake them for nevi or melanoma, and they'll remove them and biopsy them. And it turns out that you will see increased pigmentation of the basilar layer of the seborrheic keratosis. And that gives them its kind of brown or tannish appearance. All right, what are we seeing right here? This almost looks like that first picture we showed.
So this is an external photo of possibly the left eye. In the lower lid, there seems to be, again, this fleshy colored raised lesion. It almost doesn't quite look stuck on, but kind of possibly stuck on.
Kind of almost stuck on. And then we look at the path here, and what are we seeing here?
So it's a hyperkeratosis, squamous cell, epithelium with acanthosis, and there's marked atypia of the
atypia. Look at the little nucleoli and the chromatin. So some atypia here. What's going on underneath here?
Looks like there's cellulostosis to those connective tissue.
Okay, so this is definitely on sun-exposed skin. You've got this solar elastosis underneath here. So what do you think this would be?
Actinic keratosis.
Exactly. So this is kind of a, I almost call this a pre-malignant. And so you're starting to get atypia in the epithelium. You're getting a lot of breakdown of the subepithelial tissue. And so an actinic keratosis is when it's starting to get more active than a simple seborrheic keratosis or papilloma. So as it's getting more active, you get more concerned because there's a glial line here, it's a little bit more active, still lots of keratin, still thick epithelium, definitely intraepithelial, you know, the epithelial membrane is completely intact. So this is called an actinic keratosis, so kind of a almost beginning of a carcinoma in situ, but not quite. And I'm sorry, oh, that's not a good picture, I better retake that. So you can see another close-up here. You can see how you get these keratin whorls in here. You get a lot of nucleoli in here, a lot of activity. And so this is almost like a carcinoma in situ at this point, because it's got a lot more activity, but it's still intraepithelial. All right, what are we looking at right here?
So this looks like left eye, and on the lower lid margin, you see an irregular ulcerated lesion that's about midline in the eye, and it has kind of curly borders.
What would your concern be here?
I would be concerned about a squamous cell carcinoma or some sort of premalignant cell carcinoma in situ.
So when you look right here,
also basal cell carcinoma.
Okay, good, basal cell. So, you know, again, when you hear hoofbeats, you want to think horses rather than zebras. So if you were to just pick a random tumor of the lid, what would be more common, squamous or basal?
Are we at the VA or not?
Even at the VA, believe it or not.
Is basal more common?
Yeah, exactly. As a matter of fact, if you look at all lid tumors that have been removed, 90% are basal cell, and squamous cell is maybe 5 or 6%. So really, basal cell is by far and away the most common. And you see the pearly raised edges there with the ulceration in the center. Now, this is a bit of a concern because what else are you seeing aside from that?
There's a lot of blood around the inferior.
So it's kind of ulcerated, and so it's blood. How far do you think we need to remove tissue to make sure we get this all?
Probably to the medial lateral borders. I mean, you can kind of see it extending.
Yeah, look how thick that is. Yeah. All the way to there and even all the way to here. And look how you've lost lashes here. So it's thick, you've lost lashes. I mean, this patient is, we're talking major reconstructive surgery because they're losing that whole lower lid right there. Now, sometimes these lesions can look different. And instead of being ulcerated, this almost looked like a cyst, but it was solid. It's kind of a solid looking lesion here. But again, you see lots of lashes over here. You see a little notching of the lid margin. Believe it or not, those two were the same thing. This is what it shows. So what is this?
So this is going to be morpheiform and nodular basal cell carcinoma.
Exactly. So this is a basal cell carcinoma. And basal cell is characterized by this palisading. Now, remember I said that just the basilar layer of the epithelium, you get normal palisading. But this is, these are now little nodules of tumor that are below the surface epithelium. And so these tend to have these nuclei line up around the edge of the lesion. We call this palisading. And when you look close, the nuclei look pretty benign. You know, the pretty benign nuclei, not a lot of nucleoli. Large nuclei, takes up most of the cell, pretty scant cytoplasm around them. And this looks pretty benign. And the nice thing is this behaves the way it looks. I mean, these are pretty benign lesions. They don't metastasize. They can invade locally, but they don't metastasize. Sir?
So when you're looking at melanocytic nests versus a basophilic nest, are you looking for that artifactual separation too?
Well, the other thing is when you see nests of cells like melanocytes form, the cells are all solid. Whereas you can look at this, the cells are lined up around the edge, so they're not solid in here, they're lined up on the edge, so it looks different.
Okay.
And there you see the close-up, so very benign appearing. Okay. Now, they can be nodular, which is the most common, they can be nodulocystic, they can even have cysts in the center of them. But again, look at the palisading around the edge. Now, the other thing that you get is, because these cells are pretty densely packed, as we process them pathologically, the tumor cells shrink a little bit more in processing than do the tissue around them. So we call it a meaningful artifact. You get this little halo of shrinkage around them. And it's an artifact. I mean, it's good processing, but you see this in basal cells. You don't see this in other regions. So it's a meaningful artifact. So here you can see that little differential shrinking of tissue around the basal cells that are here. Alright, Becca, what's different about this picture as opposed to the previous one?
So it looks like a different stain here.
That's just different with the same stain.
The same stain. The patterns of the cellular architecture.
Alright, so you still kind of see this shrinkage here, right? But instead of those big nodules, there's little small fingers of tumor. And what's the cells in between them? What kind of cells are these right here?
Fibroblasts.
Fibroblasts. And so you've got little tiny fingers of tumor cells in between all this background of this serous or fibroblastic, you know, connective tissue. What is this?
It's still a basal cell.
Still a basal cell, but what kind?
I don't.
This is the kind I want you to remember. This is a morpheiform. And so morpheiform basal cells have a worse prognosis than nodular or nodular cystic. And the reason is these little fingers of tumor cells will grow underneath the epithelium, and they'll induce this connective tissue reaction around them. And so when you've got a nodular basal cell, you can cut the whole thing out and you know you got it all. With these, they can spread under the skin, they can spread around the side. So these are difficult to know if you got it all out.
Can you ever have like both occurring at the same time?
Oh yeah, you can have all kinds of varieties and depending on what part of the tumor you look at. But when you do these, if you see a morpheiform, then in order to ensure that you've got all of that out, you want to consider doing what's called Mohs surgery. So M-O-H-S, not Mo, Mo Howard. Mohs, M-O-H-S. And so Mohs surgery is where you cut out little pieces of tissue and you send it for frozens and they do it right on the spot and make sure you get them all out. So if you see a morpheiform, you may want to do Mohs surgery. Now, sometimes these can look different. Tina, what's different about this one as opposed to the previous one?
So the pattern looks different, also seeing a lot more keratin.
All right, so up here, look, there's those nice
palisading,
nice looking basal cell. And down here, you've got all this pink. You've got keratin in here. It's
more squamousy.
More squamousy, but still looks basal-y. Here, so what do we call this?
I forget which one of these, but it's both.
And so you just put the two words in, and that's how you remember it, it's basal squame. And so you can get, now basal cells are interesting. They arise from a pluripotential cell that lives along the basilar layer of the epithelium. And so that cell can give rise to different other types of cells. And so you can sometimes get pure basal cells, you get a basal cell that looks like a squame next to it. So this is called a basal squame. These are important because a lot like morpheiform, these can be more aggressive. And so you want to make sure that you get all of these out. So if you get a squamous element into them or you get a morpheiform element into them, then they have more chance they can spread. So I said that basal cells are benign, but if you let them go, this can happen. And so this was a lady, Rick Anderson saw her. She's a rancher from Nevada, a stubborn little lady. They said, you've got a morpheiform basal cell. We have to go do more surgery and remove it. She said, I'm an old lady. I'm going to die. Leave me alone. So she went back to her ranch. 10 years later, her daughter dragged her in. And why? Because it smelled. And so if you look, the tumor's not only taken over half of her face, but it goes back into here. There was even CSF dripping out here. And so even though basal cells are a benign tumor, if you let it grow for 10 years, I mean, this is beyond housekeeping. This is a hemiheadectomy now at this point. So, and you know, I mean, she's a tough old rancher lady. She said, I'm old. I was 80. Now she's 90. And she has this. And so take care of these because even though they're, quote, relatively benign, if you let them grow for 10 years, they can cause this. So always, especially if it's morpheiform, basal squame, something like that. All right, Nico.
So in the upper eyelid, it's like this large lesion, and the surface looks like there's some alterations.
How is this different than the basal cell? So it's kind of a bigger solid lesion. It's not ulcerated in the center. It's got almost this parchment paper look to it. And it's kind of orange, and it's big, and so what do you think this could be?
This could be a squamous cell.
All right, so this is more consistent with the squamous cell. Now, if you think about basal cells are definitely sun-induced. So where are basal cells more commonly seen? Lower lid, medial canthus. Why? Because your brow shades the upper lid. And so I don't see any Cro-Magnons in here. Some of us have bigger brows than others, and so they're even more protective. I don't see any here, but you know, the squames can grow both lower and upper lid. And so the squames can come up here in the upper lid. And now sometimes squames can look like this. How is this one different?
So it there's ulceration still, and this is the, it looks more flat. It's the rodent.
So this is called the rodent ulcer, and how do you remember that?
Somebody taking a bite.
It looks like a rodent ate it. So, I mean, that's not what a rodent means, but that's how you remember it. So it's a rodent ulcer. So a rodent, you know, took a nip out of that cheese right there and left it in there. So there's your rodent ulcer. You see that? Look at the rest of their skin. I mean, this person has been out in the, you know, probably a rancher or construction worker or something. Look at the skin, the sun damage on their skin all over. So this is, again, a different way that this can present. It can sometimes, the squamous cell can have this little rodent, this little ulcerator look to it. All right, and how do we tell this is squamous? What do we see?
You just have, like, lots of cells underneath.
So you look, here's the epithelium, and here's these cells, broken right through the epithelium, and they're down here. The predominant color, basal cell is blue, basal bilirubin. Squamous cells are pink, because there's keratin in them, there's pink in them, it's proliferation of the squamous cells. And so you look at this large squamous cell carcinoma, it's pink when you look at it. All right, Tara, what are these things right here?
Keratin whorls.
Exactly, so you see these keratin whorls, keratin furrows. You can see the nuclei have a lot of nucleoli in them. There's pleomorphism. Some are big, some are small. And then you can see that the keratin is in here, but you know, you see it's pink. It's not blue. It's squamous cell. All right. Chuck, what do we see in here?
It's an external color photograph of the right eye. And it looks like there's a lot of either bleeding or ulceration of the upper lids and the spread to the conjunctiva as well, lower lids, medial canthus.
So what's your concern here?
So a tumor of some sort that's very invasive at this point.
So this is very concerning lesion. Look, there's loss of lashes here. It's really thick. It's got kind of this yellowish, whitish look to it. What do you think? What would your concern be here? What kind of tumor?
Like a sebaceous carcinoma.
Sebaceous carcinoma. So the problem is this is called the great mimicker. And so this particular patient went to a doc in the box, and they were told they had blepharoconjunctivitis. And so every doc in the box gives any patient with a red eye, they get gentamicin. Now, I don't know, have you ever used gentamicin? I mean, we haven't used it for 30 years, but every doc in the box gives everybody with a red eye gentamicin. So a week later, they're not better. So then they go to the optometrist. And the optometrist says, oh, yeah, this is definitely blepharoconjunctivitis. We're going to give you Tobradex. And so, you know, another week later, it's not better, and it finally comes in. And so this is indeed a meibomian gland, a sebaceous gland carcinoma. And so this is not blepharoconjunctivitis. Look how thick that lid margin is. Look at the loss of lashes. Look at the yellowish here. So This is called the great mimicker because if it's diffuse, it can look like blepharoconjunctivitis. If it's focal, it can look like a chalazion. And so you really want to not miss these. And so this is indeed a sebaceous gland. Now sometimes they're not quite this prominent. But again, look at this lid. It's diffusely thickened all the way over here. Lots of lashes, yellowish dots in there. So this is a meibomian, sebaceous gland carcinoma. And so when you look at it, sometimes these can be fairly differentiated. And so if you look at this, it almost still has like a sebaceous type lobule here. But look at the cells. Look at the nucleoli in there. Now here's the dissolved lipid. There's lots of lipid in here, so all these little empty spaces are lipid. Now if you look at it, remember I said a basal cell looks benign, behaves benign. A sebaceous gland carcinoma looks malignant, behaves malignant. These can metastasize, so you got to not miss these. People can die from these. And so this looks very aggressive, and indeed it is very aggressive. And the other thing is if you look at them, what is this thing right here? Is that right there?
It's mitotic figure.
Mitotic figures. You got mitotic figures, clumped chromatin, multiple nucleoli, dissolved lipid, another mitotic figure. I mean, that's nasty looking. And so you don't have to be a pathologist to realize that, that's something that is bad. And what is this stain again?
Is it oil red O?
An oil red O. So it stains oil, those red little O's. And so what kind of tissue do you have to have in order to do an oil red O stain?
Sebaceous gland.
Fresh tissue.
Tissue.
Fresh. So just remember our normal processing when we dehydrate and we put other materials, xylenes, and in there, it leaches out the fat. So if you want to stain lipid, you have to have fresh tissue. So this is a fresh tissue. All right, what are we seeing right here?
Okay, external photograph of maybe right eye. Lower lid lesion that's pigmented. There is no loss of eyelashes. It's slightly raised, but no surrounding erythema. But
what would you think this differential here?
I would think at this point it would either be, best case scenario, just like a nevus.
Okay.
Worst case scenario, you want to look at more characteristics to rule out like a melanoma type
picture. So when you see a pigmented lesion like this, you want to measure it. You want to take a picture of it. But you don't see loss of lashes. You don't see notching of the lid margins. Probably a nevus. But what you want to do, you want to watch it. And so you just watch them carefully, make sure it doesn't grow. And we do the path, and indeed, what do we see here?
So we see like nest-like cells of pigment.
So Lee, remember you had asked about the difference between the palisading and all? You see that the nest is totally filled with cells, as opposed to cells lining up on the side. So the 9 melanocytes here. Now, how do we classify nevi?
So it depends on where they're located.
Okay, so how would you classify this one?
So this one looks like it's more in the dermis than in the like the junction of the epidermis and dermis.
I would still say this is the junction right here.
Yeah, you're right, so it's probably junctional.
So this is junctional, yeah. But it also has nests of melanocytes down in the dermis, so we would call this
junctional.
Both, it's called compound.
Compound, okay.
So just up here at the junction, the melanocytes are there, we call it junctional.
Mm-hmm.
If some of the melanocytes drop down deeper into the dermis, we call it compound, meaning both junctional and dermal. And then if it's purely underneath, like this one, then we call it dermal. Now again, that's a misnomer because there's no dermis in the eyelid, but it's entrenched in the literature. We should call it subepithelial, but we call it dermal. So you see right here, you've got the nests of melanocytes and you've got no junctional component. Why that's important is, if the melanocytes still have a junctional component, they still theoretically have a malignant potential. Once they've lost that junctional component, they kind of mature and they drop down below, they really don't have a malignant potential. So once they're pure dermal, you don't see malignant potential.
Is that because you would think it's kind of counterintuitive because the lower they go, you think the more invasive they might
actually
be.
Actually, the lower they go, the more mature they are.
Okay,
so initially when the melanocytes come out from the neural crest and migrate to the junction, they'll start to grow, and then as they drop off, it means they've been growing for a long time and they're more mature. All right, what are we seeing here?
So this, the external color photo of the right eye, or sorry, left eye, and this is a pigmented, very extensive lower lid lesion that does look like it's disrupted. I don't see many, if any, hair follicles.
Yeah, so you'd really be worried about this one. Yeah. So this would be a lesion of concern, and when we look at it, you know, initially you look at these, there are, you know, some benign-looking melanocytes here that was probably needless to begin with, but then we look deeper, and what do we see?
So I see some nucleoli.
Exactly. Look at those nucleoli, look at the different sizes and shapes. And so this has now gone from a simple nevus to a superficially invasive malignant melanoma. And again, these can metastasize. Now fortunately, when you look at all the lid tumors, melanomas and meibomian carcinomas are only about 1 or 2%. So they're fortunately uncommon, but they're getting more common. Why? Because my generation, the baby boom generation, spent time in the sun and got that beautiful, healthy tan, you know, that healthy glow of your skin. And so melanomas are really going up now as the baby boom generation ages. And so we may see more and more of these as you guys get out into practice. Okay, what are we seeing here?
So something wrong with the left eye, I think. looks like a very... couldn't say if it's propped dark or not, but the left low lid is very much hanging down over major ptosis, major swelling.
So when you feel this, it's not hot, it's not infected. This has been slowly going on. It's very doughy. You feel that it's solid, it's doughy.
Okay, so you know, like a cellulitis is beyond the differential, but maybe lower down based on that description. Maybe that is like a possibly like a lipoma or.
Here's the path.
So that looks like a lot of lymphocytes.
Yep.
So lymphoma would definitely be high.
Exactly. So now lymphoma, you know, lymphoma is more common in the conch and in the orbit, but you can still get lymphoma in the lid. Usually it's a spread from an orbital lymphoma. But don't forget, you can get lymphoma of the lid too. And it's very solid and doughy. That's the key thing. So it's not a hot, acute, you know, preceptocellulitis or something like that. It's a doughy infiltrated, so you can actually get lymphoma. And last but not least, just this weird thing. Lee, what are we seeing here?
So external color photo of the face, and you see this large, looks, well, I would say ulcerated, but it looks like some elevation. It's erythematous. It's crusted lesion of the upper eyelid.
So it's kind of reddish blue, it's solid, it's crusted because there's stuff on it. And you look at it, it has all these mitotic figures. Really active, but it's got these big cells. We finally worked it up, it's got these little inclusions in it. This is called a Merkel cell. So it's very weird. They think it's maybe one of the little nerve ending derived tumors. And just I wanted to show you that there's all kinds of weird tumors you can see sometimes in the day. So this happens to be a Merkel cell tumor, and it just looks so cool to see it because nothing looks like that. So I've seen two of these in 35 years, so not really a common tumor. And last but not least, you can remember there's other tumors that can show up here. Look at this. This is some epithelial cells here, almost forming little ducts. They look kind of glandular, and they're surrounded by this stuff right here. And we do a special mucin carmine stain, a stain for mucin. So this is a...
mucinous carcinoma.
All right, so this is actually a mucinous adenocarcinoma. And just again, to show you that weird tumors can occur in the lids. And so Fred Jacobiak, who was like the most brilliant lecturer in all of ophthalmology, who's now... he's got to be 80. I think he still kind of sees people in Boston, but he describes this as an island of you know, adenocells swimming in a sea of mucin. There's this sea of mucin and these islands of these cells, and it's just because it looks cool and there's no other tumor that looks like this. So you can get rare tumors that, you know, that attack the eyes. Now, fortunately, they don't put too many of these zebras on boards. And so the key thing is know your basic tumors. Know your basal cell, your squamous cell, your melanomas, and your meibomian gland carcinomas. And if you know those cold, then you know, you'll be okay when you get to the Spartan boards. And there you see, this is what I love. Let's put a city in contrast. There's laundry hanging out on the windows here. They're just hanging out all over here. Yet, right here is a satellite dish for the TV. So you've got the satellite dish, you've still got laundry hanging out on the balcony in the big little restaurant right here. Okay, so next week is conge. So know your conge, and we'll see you next Tuesday.